Welcome everyone to this flagship seminar, part of the bank's wider engagement program. We've got a fantastic audience, 250 and counting it when I last looked, which just shows how much interest there is in this particular topic and this particular speaker, despite the competing interests of getting your haircut and going to the pub. So let me welcome our very special guest, David Hamilton. After a PhD in organic chemistry, David spent 4 years in the pharmaceutical industry, developing drugs for cardiovascular disease and cancer. Inspired by the placebo effect, he then left industry to write books and to educate people in how they can best harness their minds and their emotions to improve not just their happiness, but their health as well. And the rest, as they say, is history. David's gone on to author 10 books, including The Little Book of Kindness and How Your Mind Can Heal Your Body, and indeed also the Amazon bestseller, The 5 Side Effects of Kindness, which I actually read over the weekend. It's absolutely great, and I say that despite not being on commission. David speaks, blogs regularly, and is the resident, and I love this, kindness czar for Psychology's magazine. That's a job title we all want. He's the monthly columnist for Soul and Spirit magazine, and in 2016 was voted best writer by readers of Kindred Spirit magazine. All told, David is plainly one of the leading thinkers and leading writers globally on what I think is one of the most important, but often underemphasized, aspects of both us as individuals and for us as societies, namely kindness, the role it plays, and indeed how best that kindness is to be nurtured. Who better than David to answer the question, how do we build back, not just better, but kinder too? These are among the questions I hope we're going to be able to explore with David today. I'm absolutely thrilled he's taken the time to come to the bank today. And David, welcome to the bank.
Oh, thank you very much, Andy. It's a real pleasure. I'm really grateful that we're going to have this conversation today. Thanks for the nice introduction. It's funny hearing someone introduce me always makes me sound more interesting than I actually am, I think.
I know that's not true. I know that's not true, David. Yeah. And we'll demonstrate that now. So the rough format for everyone is we'll spend roughly half the time, David and I, having a chit-chat. And then we'll pass across to you, the audience, to ask some questions of David. So please take the time, if you have questions, to stick them in the Q&A box on GoToWebinar. And I'll try and get through and curate as many of those as possible in the time. But let me kick off, David. I just really take you back to how it all started. Obviously, you started life as a scientist. So what was it that drew you into, you know, applying some of those techniques, some of those that experience to the area of kindness? What prompted all that?
Well, my main area when I worked in the pharmaceutical industry was cardiovascular. I worked a little bit on cancer. So when you're doing cardiovascular, you learn how you can determine if a medicine is working or not. And I think I was on about my second or third book, and I was reading through some medical journals, and I came across a meditation type practice. It was a Tibetan Buddhist style where you cultivate a sense of compassion and kindness for people. You really just think nice things about people, and you think of reasons why you really value people, and you wish them freedom from suffering. And in the study, they were measuring something to do with the cardiovascular system. They were actually measuring inflammation in blood vessels, and they were using a standard measure that I was very familiar with from my time working in the pharmaceutical industry. And I had to double take when I looked at the results, and I thought, that's incredible, because the amount of improvement they were getting was comparable to what you might get from, you know, a kind of experimental medicine. I was like, what these people have done is sat for 6 weeks for 20 minutes a day, and they've just felt compassion and they've wished kind thoughts for people, and it was actually having a physical effect on the heart. And I thought, from now on, my next book is all about that kind of stuff. And I just really dived into the medical journals for the next year, really finding everything I could about all the different ways that kindness and compassion impact our emotions, our mind, body, the whole thing.
Could you say, that's really fascinating, on that, because I think people would probably get some of the link from kindness to feeling good, the sort of the neurological.
Yeah.
But the biological bit, the kind of physical health thing, is a bit of a wow. Could you elaborate a bit on, well, maybe on both bits, but particularly on how it affects our biologies as well as our neurologies, David?
Yeah, well, the principal way it works is that, you know, kindness is, physiologically speaking, the opposite of stress. And I say the opposite of stress, you know, stress, we can be in a, you know, stress is a feeling, and it's not really much, it's not really to do with the situation that you're in, it's to do with how you feel about the situation you're in, because two people can be in exact same situation, one feels stressed, the other doesn't. Now, when you feel stressed, the feeling produces what most people are familiar with, stress hormones. We call, you know, things like adrenaline, cortisol. I think many people are familiar with those. Scientists call them stress hormones. Now, when you be kind, because of how that feels, it's the feeling that that it generates from helping someone, you produce not stress hormones, you produce kindness hormones. I call them kindness hormones, really to draw that parallel with stress, that they're produced because of how it feels. And if you had to chart through in the body all the physical effects of stress, you find that the physical effects of kindness hormones are opposite in direction. They're all, sometimes equal in strength, but they go opposite in direction. So, for example, stress hormones are known to increase blood pressure, but kindness hormones can do the exact opposite, and they can actually reduce blood pressure. You know, so, you know, stress hormones can make us age faster. Kindness hormones can slow down that kind of process. So in many ways, to make it really simple, it's really just physiologically the opposite of what happens when you feel stressed.
And how do we think, I think this is really, really fascinating, actually. This is a, you know, this is the ultimate de-stress device. How do we think about kindness? And I might come back to you for a definition of kindness as well, actually, just so we all know exactly what you're talking about, David, on that. How would something like kindness then relate to, you know, something that might be familiar to many people on the call, you know, mindfulness or meditation, things that sort of calm them up? How do we think about the differences or the similarities between those two things?
Right. Very, very similar. You know, actually, see, many people are familiar with mindfulness. And for those listeners who are not very familiar, think of it like this way. If you breathe, which I'm hoping you're doing right now, but let's say you were to breathe and then notice that you're breathing. So in noticing that you're breathing, you're becoming mindful of the fact that you're breathing. So in a nutshell, that's mindfulness. It's literally just being mindful of the fact that you're breathing. And funnily enough, if you were to look at the brain, what happens when you've been mindful like that is you actually take a portion of the brain to the gym. So if I went to the gym and worked out my bicep, then you would notice two things happening. First, the muscle would become firmer, and then the muscle would become larger. So if you work out a region of the brain, the exact same thing happens. Although neuroscientists don't call it muscle growth, they've got a really fancy name. It's called neuroplasticity, but it means the same. If ever you hear the term neuroplasticity, it's really just the brain's version of muscle growth. And so what happens when you breathe and then notice that that's what you're doing, you give it your mindful attention to it, you work out this portion of the brain and it becomes firmer and it becomes stronger. So there's a real physical change in the brain. But let's say instead of doing mindfulness, you do kindfulness. And kindfulness is really just where you notice that you're breathing, but then you take some of your attention off of the fact that you're breathing. And you move your attention now onto thinking kind thoughts about people, onto just thinking reasons why you value people in your life, reasons why you know, that you might be really grateful that a person contributed to your life or something that they did, or even might think of someone in your life who's suffering right now and really wish that things go well for them. But what's happening is you're generating a feeling. Now, if you were to scan the brain, it turns out that you're working this whole part of the brain here at the front, but with an ever so slight bias to the left-hand side and further in towards the middle. And what's happening is kindfulness, i.e. thinking kindness and feeling the feelings, is causing a physical change to the actual structure of the brain. And this actually partly explains why being kind in many, many scientific studies, consistent kindness is associated with improvements in happiness. And it's also protective in the long term towards depression. Doesn't mean that if you be kind, you're never going to be unhappy and you're never going to be depressed. Doesn't mean that at all. But there's a degree of protective effect there. There's a kind of inner resilience that's caused by the actual physical change in the brain. Just like if I worked out a muscle and then I had to lift something, or if something dropped, I might be able to support the weight a little bit better because I've built that muscle. So if you build this muscle, you can support the weight of life that little bit better. If that makes sense.
It makes a lot of sense. It's a very nice metaphor and a very nice way of putting it, David. And just on the, you mentioned there about having kind thoughts. What's the balance here between sort of thinking kind things and doing kind things? I mean, do you have to be doing it for it to really matter, or is it enough for it to take place between your two ears?
Yeah, what's interesting, I mean, obviously it's a better value to others if you actually do something. But the really important scientific thing here is that you get many of the effects because of what you're doing between your ears, the thinking of it. Because at the end of the day, the neurological and the physical effects of kindness are down to how it feels to you. It's the feelings, just like a stressful situation. It's how that feels to you that's causing the effect, not the situation itself, but how it feels. So it's the feelings that you generate through what you're doing with your thoughts, with your mind, that are causing the physiological effects. Obviously, as I said, it's much better for other people if you then put that into practice and actually say, okay, now I feel this compassion, or I'm thinking these nice things, I think I'll go and say something or do something helpful for that person.
And just on those physiological effects, David, because this is fascinating reading your book over the weekend. I mean, you talk about, I mean, there's at least two, probably many more than two, but the two you mention is that, you know, one, the heart benefits, you know, use of the heart is good for the heart. And the second is aging, something, you know, it slows down, which is kind of fantastic news. Can you say a little bit about those two?
Yeah, well it comes down to the kindness hormone, because it turns out that the kindness hormone sort of parks on the lining of our blood vessels. And I say parks, you know, if you go into one of these really large, you know, motorway car parks, and you've got different shapes and sizes of parking bays that are receptive to vehicles of different shapes and sizes. So you've got really big ones for buses and caravans, and middle-sized ones for SUVs, and normal ones for cars, and little dinky ones for motorcycles. So inside your body, on all cells, but here we're talking about the cardiovascular system, inside your blood vessels, you also have vehicles and parking bays. But again, scientists don't really call them vehicles and parking bays. We like to sound more cool than that. So we call them hormones and receptors. But if ever you hear the term hormone and receptor, what you're really hearing is vehicle and parking bay. And so what happens, you produce the kindness hormone because of how kindness feels to you, because of something you're thinking about someone and feeling, or because you're actually in the moment, you're doing something and connecting with a person or an animal, and it feels nice, it feels sweet. So you turn on the little tap, and in come the kindness hormones in the brain and in the heart. And then they park on the blood vessels. And what happens is it causes a softening effect on the blood vessels. And at the end of the day, they go and expand. I mean, they make that noise as well, I suppose. And then your heart is thinking, you know what? I don't really have to work quite as hard to push all that blood through, because the heart's thinking there's more space now. So the heart kind of chills out a little bit, eases off some of its pressure. And what you get is a reduction in blood pressure. So that's a kind of semi-scientific way of describing actually how the kindness hormone reduces blood pressure. But what's fascinating, and this is how it relates to aging, is at the same time now, the kindness hormone likes to keep things clean. So on its being, it happens to have a brush and pan with it. And it, whenever it sees debris around, it just cleans it up. And when I say debris, that's the scientific term for the two groups of substances in the body that play a big role in heart disease and, you know, even memory loss, Alzheimer's, these kind of things. Most people have probably heard of inflammation and free radicals. So those are the kind of things that float around, and they play a big role in memory loss, heart disease, aging processes. So the kindness hormone, it turns out, actually, whenever it encounters them, it sweeps them up in its wee little brush and pan and gets rid of them. Now, this is where it relates to aging, because one of the most fascinating things is it does that inside our skin cells. In fact, inside all cells. Scientists were looking at the aging process, and they took cells from the skin that make up 95% of the skin, and they put them under stress in the lab. And that stress was meant to simulate, you know, lifestyle stresses that we might be under in our lives, or mental and emotional stress, or even, you know, just physical stress from things. And they measured high levels of these free radical things that cause aging. The same kind of things that happen when you've got too much UV light, too much sunlight. That's what happens. It's free radicals. Anyway, they did the experiment, lots of these aging things. Then they did the same thing again, but this time they put a few drops of the kindness hormone in. And amazingly, the levels of those aging substances literally fell through the floor. Just literally dropped. Now, you can't eat or drink the kindness hormone. The only way you can get it into your skin and into your joints and your heart and everything is to produce it through how you're being. You know, Andy, I've been practicing this for 94 years now. Yeah, I just dye my hair grey to make myself look more my age, you know.
And this might explain why I'm only 17 years old as well, David.
Yeah, yeah.
I've got a follow-up question, actually. It's from the chat, and I took it early. It's from Alison. It says, do you get those benefits, neurological and physiological, if you're the recipient of kindness, or just if you're the deliverer of kindness? Do recipients get the same thing?
Yeah, thanks for the question, Alison. Yeah, you can get them if you're the recipient, you can also get them. Again, it comes down to how it feels. So for example, if in receiving the kindness, in that moment, you feel gratitude towards that person, or you feel a little bit of warmth and connection with the person. These are ways like warmth and connection and bonding. That's how we produce the kindness hormone. It's the feeling. So if in the receiving of kindness, you feel gratitude or a sense of connection with the person, then yes, you will actually in the moment get that. And that also means, which is also true, is you can get the benefits from witnessing an act of kindness as well. If watching someone be kind to someone else, even if it's on video, if that inspires or moves you, then again, you'll get the benefits as well. Again, it all comes down to how that feels.
Fascinating. I want to take another question from the floor, one that was sent in advance from Saman. It's quite a personal one, actually, for you, Dave, which is, what is the one lasting impression or memory, David, you have of the impact made through an act of kindness, either by you or by someone that you know?
That's a fantastic question. Thanks for that. I would say my mum. There were times when I was growing up, my mum and dad struggled financially for a number of years, and it was very, very tough. We grew up in a little village in central Scotland called Banknock, actually a tiny little place, and my mum and dad were really struggling a lot. But my mum just dedicated, she still does even now, and dedicated everything to the family. And I remember sometimes watching my mum reorganizing the dinner plate. So I have three sisters, so there's six, my mum and my dad, three sisters and myself, six of us, and I'm watching my mum reorganizing all the dinner plates, and she's taken a couple of chips from her plate and putting them onto my dad's plate, you know, a piece of carrot from her plate putting onto my sister's plate, and reducing her own stuff down to make sure that everyone else had enough to eat. And I saw her doing that. so many times, and also when I'd overheard conversations, and yet with between her and my dad, that they were struggling, and yet if any of us needed something, without any hesitation, my mum was right there, and she would do whatever she could. And there were times when I would go to my bed sometimes, and I had a wee cry, because I was so moved. And I remember several times lying in my bed in that kind of state, saying, one day I'm going to be like my mum. I will be a kind person like my mum. Now, I don't know if I even come close to being the quality of person that my mum is and still is, but certainly that, on a personal level, that's probably, I guess, that type of experience in a very important and very large way has shaped much of the person that I've become as an adult. Thanks for the question. That was a terrific question.
It was a great question. Can I ask you, I mean, you've mentioned some of the benefits that as a of kindness, as a giver of kindness, to our bodies, to our minds. In other words, it's doing us good to do kind things, which actually sounds a bit selfish. Should we be worried about that, David? You know, is there a dilemma there at the heart of this, that we're doing things maybe for self-interested reasons that sort of feel like the opposite of kindness?
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean, because here's the thing. The moment you're aware that there's a benefit to be gained, whether psychologically, emotionally, physically, from kindness, that little thought pops into your head, doesn't it? See, you know, in some ways, I think it was easier for me when I didn't know all this stuff. I just did stuff because it was the right thing to do. So the moment you have that awareness, what you have to then decide for yourself is, even though there's a benefit, it's not why I'm doing it. Even though there's a benefit, I'm doing this because it's the right thing to do, because it's what that person needs. It's because I genuinely feel moved and want to help. You can't take out of the equation, you know, the fact that you will benefit. We're actually genetically wired for kindness. You know, the kindness, the gene that produces the kindness hormone is one of the oldest in the human genome, about almost 500 million years old and 3.5 days. Yeah, I'm only joking about 3.5 days, but it's one of the oldest genes in the human genome. So we are wired for it, and that's why there are physical benefits. So the moment you know of it, you can't not get these benefits, but you just have to decide that even though I will gain from this, and it's not why I'm doing it. And you have to just commit and take that conscious decision that I'm doing this in this moment because I'm trying to help. I genuinely care in this moment.
Fantastic. I'm going to take another question from the sent in advance. I think it's a really interesting one, actually, from Diana. David, and the question is, why do you think schools don't teach this topic? And could we and should we be changing that and the curriculum?
You know, I think it's happening now, actually. I've got a friend who runs a little charity called 52 Lives, a woman called Jamie Thurston. And basically every week of the year, she and her team make a difference in someone's life. It's called 52 Lives, where every week, the 52 weeks of the year, they make an appeal for someone who's in need at this moment. And they recently started up a little thing called School of Kindness. And basically her and her husband, they actually teach kindness, because I contribute a few videos to that, and they teach kindness in schools. Now, over the couple of years, obviously before the pandemic, in the previous year, I had a sudden large increase in the number of schools asking me if I could come in and give a little talk to the kids. For practical reasons, it was only possible for me in my local vicinity, but I certainly visited about half a dozen schools. One of my good friends teaches in an autism unit in a school outside Glasgow. This was one of the first schools I came into, and I was just moved by the fact that the kids just loved it. And he had actually created a kindness project for the week, where the kids had actually learned all about what kindness is and what are the different ways that you can practice it, which includes practicing it for yourself. It was kindness for each other, I think, kindness in the community, and kindness for yourself. And that was their three things. And they had to practice that and then feedback to the teacher, what they'd done, and they created this big wall chart. And then I came in and we'd had a little chat, answered a few questions. And what I've noticed now is schools are taking it upon themselves to create kindness projects where they literally are doing the for themselves, deciding how can we educate the children in kindness. And I think a lot of it is coming because I think there's a need for it at the moment. But obviously also I think because when I was a kid, the science for this wasn't available. But it is now. And now that the science is available, it's something that you can actually teach with some degree of certainty. And then it becomes something really tangible that can become something that's formally taught. And so I think it's part of both, it's for both those reasons. One, there's a need. And secondly, there's actually now some science behind it that was not there in the past. So I think we will see more schools doing this.
Well, I think that'd be really good. I mean, it's interesting what you say, because you know, lots of people might be, you know, they might find science difficult. And here is a way of, you know, making science relevant to someone's everyday lives, right? This would make, you know, science appealing to the social scientists. It would make social science seem more appealing to the scientists as a kind of bridge between the two. I really like that idea. Mm. Can I ask about, you touched upon it there, David, the last 12 months and lockdown. And what your sense is for what lockdown has done to the amount of kindness that's been shown in society. You know, has it been positive? Has it been less positive? Are there some lessons from that experience that we want to sort of hang on to long after lockdown has gone that would help boost the average amount of kindness that we give and receive? What's your sense of how we've moved over the last 12 months?
You know, what I've personally witnessed is a large increase in kindness and awareness of it. In fact, I remember it was at the second month of lockdown that the theme of Mental Health Awareness Week was kindness, and that was an amazing thing because it really put it on the map, you know, for a lot of people and a lot of individuals, organisations, companies. But what I've noticed through all of this last year, because I found myself doing a lot of talks online on the subject of kindness, and what I've noticed is people, especially when we first got into the pandemic, people making more of an effort to check up on family and friends, you know, to make a FaceTime call or a Zoom call, just to check in and make sure, are you okay? And when you pass by, even when you pass by someone in a street, I noticed myself doing it and other people, I think in the past we may have walked past, oh, hi, how are you doing? And then I noticed, I really mean it now. And I think how you doing seemed to be just something that you say as just words that are just a greeting that have sort of lost their meaning because it's just part of a greeting that you don't really think about what it means. And all of a sudden I found myself and I asked around as well and everyone's saying, yeah, I say, how are you doing? And I really mean it. I really feel like are you okay? Given what's happening in the world, I think what it did is it put people more in touch with the compassion that's always there. I think we all have huge volumes of compassion, but sometimes life is so challenging that other things get on the surface. And sometimes we just need a reason, so another focus to almost put some of that stuff away and the natural compassion comes out. And certainly, you know, remind myself when lockdown started, people going checking up on neighbours, especially elderly neighbours, are you okay? Is there any way that I can help you? And these are kind of things I'd never witnessed before. So I think this, for those types of lessons, I think these are things we'll always remember because people, I spoke to people that said they've met people on the street for the first time ever. And they've got a lot of WhatsApp groups and they're friends with them now. And these are things that would never have happened had all of this thing, these lockdowns not happened. So I think we can take a lot of good in terms of how it's altered the quality of person that we're now showing. I think we are naturally kind and compassionate, but sometimes you just need something to give you a reason to demonstrate it. So I think it's been really sweet in many ways.
And is there a way, given that we've sort of hit that sweet spot, sort of born of adversity, if you like, David, when things, as hopefully as we all hope they do, sort of start improving and the lockdown restrictions come off, and hopefully the virus is laid low, how do we hang on to that? You know, what stops it just sort of seeping away, as forgetting the good that's come from that, whether it's the casual conversation or calling on the neighbor or the Zoom call you might not otherwise have had?
Yeah, I think we almost need to remind ourselves that, you know, these are lessons that we've learned. And I think also maybe there's something that organizations can do to bring kindness in, not just as something that sits in the background, you know, like we've got an awareness of kindness, but actually it's something that the organization has as part of its mission or has in some of its higher level things. This is who we are, or this is what we do. It becomes something that is part of what you do. You know, and I think every organization is different and might find that there's different ways in which that can happen. But I think it's just about making it more visible, if that makes sense. And whichever way that can manifest in different organizations, I think the visibility gives individual. I mean, certainly some of the talks I've done for companies, a lot of them over this last year have actually made it more visible. And what they've done, what some of them have done is given the individual groups and teams the autonomy to decide for themselves how they can best practice it in their group or in their team or in their section of the company, rather than saying this is what we all have to do from now. How does it actually apply in our team and our environment, where exactly in the way that we do our job? Like, I'm working with a customer, how does that work here? Or I'm working more in teams and inside an office, how does that best play itself out here? But I think it's just about making it more visible, whether it is part of an organization or even us in our individual lives, making a decision to say, you know, let's make this a bigger part of my life. Let's make it a bigger part of my life. And, you know, kindness is the most contagious thing that I've ever come across in science. And our number between 4 and 5, actually, which is huge. So I think the more we bring this out, the more it's going to have a huge effect.
Very, very good use of the R number there, David. After
positive,
that's right. R of 4 or 5, you say, for this is the downstream effects.
Yeah, based on some research between Harvard and Yale, where they just did a business game simulation, they found that, you know, if you be kind to someone, if you were to follow that person around for the rest of the day, which I hope you don't do, but if you did, then what you would probably see is that person, because of how you made them feel, whether grateful or just moved or inspired, that person will probably be kind to, let's say the R number's 5, that person will be kind or kinder to 5 people over the course of the rest of the day. Now, what was interesting about this piece of research, they showed that it doesn't just stop there. That's at one stage. But it actually goes to 3 stages. What they found with kindness is each of those 5, because of how they feel, will also be kind or kinder to 5. And that's at 2 stages, but it goes to another stage. Each of those now 25 will be kind or kinder to 5. And what you actually get is this little ripple effect, and you get about 125 people benefiting from an act of kindness. I know I say 125, it's not exact, because obviously that'll be higher or lower depending on context, people, but as a ballpark average, you might see something like that. You know, it's like if you drop a pebble in a pond and the pebble goes plop, and then what you see is little waves, and the waves begin to push out, and at the other side of the pond, a wee lily pad's going like that. And it's got no idea why it's doing that, but it's doing that because of the wave. Now, what created the wave was the pebble dropped in a pond. Now, the pebble dropped in the pond is a metaphor for an act of kindness. You drop an act of kindness and it pushes out and it lifts not lily pads, but people's spirits and people's days, people's lives. And most of these people being affected, you have never met and probably will never meet in your entire life. But yet, the quality of their day, even if it's in a small way, is actually being impacted because of a little kind act that you did. And you know, one of the reasons why I'm saying this is I know there's probably a lot of people listening or watching right now, because I felt the same. Sometimes you feel like I'm insignificant or I'm not making a difference. And I'm telling you right now, every time you do something kind, even if it's just paying someone a compliment, saying something nice, or even helping someone in a small way, you really are making a difference. You're setting these little ripples in motion. You'll never see the outcome, but you don't need to see it. But just trust that you literally are changing the world. All of us are changing the world by these little ripples that we set in motion. And it's because of that, our number of, say, five there, between four and five, that's what makes it so contagious. It's exponential to a huge degree. So everyone here, everyone, I'm talking to everyone right now, every little thing that you do is making a difference, even if you can't directly see it right now. Because what you don't see is what happens over the rest of the day after the person you've helped goes away and gets on with their life. That's when the ripple effect unfolds.
Fantastic. I really like that. I also like, David, the lily pad dancing. That's a first at the Bank of England. No one's ever lily. Very good, you see.
That's just for you guys.
Capture of posterity now. I was going to ask you just on that about doing stuff sort of remotely like this versus doing stuff in person. Because I was thinking, surely, you know, you'd get that much more from acts of kindness that are done in person. And therefore, you know, if you like, physical acts of kindness were in some ways better or greater in their impact than doing things. Then I was thinking, but actually the virtual medium might help you reach that much broader audience and the ripples would be there. So how should we think about this, the virtual medium versus the physical medium?
You know, I think it just calls for a wee bit of creativity. You know, rather than, you know, I think we're all familiar with what it's like. You know, let's say you're walking down the street and you have an awareness. Kindness is in your mind. And what happens is you act upon opportunities to help people as they present themselves. It might be just a nice, pleasant exchange in a shop, but it might be helping someone or a physical. You see someone, you know, just hold a door for someone, something really simple. Now, many of those same opportunities don't present themselves in the virtual world. But there's other opportunities that present themselves instead. And I think we just have to be alert to it and be creative and think, well, in my environment, in my virtual world, what opportunities present themselves? And just the moment you start thinking about it, that's when you start to notice it. That's when you'll notice in your own environment, wow, I hadn't really noticed that's a way to do it before. And it, you know, it might be through your Zoom calls that you just make an extra effort just to be complimentary, an extra effort just to listen. Sometimes kindness is in listening. Yeah. You know, just being willing to listen and let someone have their say, you know, without trying to jump in, just let the person have their say. I mean, that there's multitude of ways, even though we're in a different medium right now.
I'm going to jump some questions. I want to try and fit in as many as possible, David. So apologies for jumping around a little bit.
Absolutely.
But a great question here from Roz. She says, do you think that this type of thinking in science is beginning to catch up with what's been in some religion and spirituality for a long time now? In other words, the thinking of kind thoughts, the thinking of others, rather than the self, you know, is really bringing the science to what's been there for thousands of years.
Absolutely. Because I think many religious and spiritual traditions have compassion and kindness as a backbone. You know, I think there's lots of different traditions, but I think what's common to all of them is a backbone of compassion and service of others, wishing for the best for other people. So I think it's really... absolutely, Roz. Science is catching up. And what's interesting, actually, is some of the research that's been done on kindness has actually used a kindfulness, I call it kindfulness, but a meditation practice from Tibetan Buddhism called loving kindness, or they call it metta. It means like a universe, you cultivate a sense of universal love and kindness and compassion for people and for animals and for yourself. And so lots of the research on the physiological effects of kindness are actually done by asking a large group of people to practice that meditation, that prayer, if you will. And the reason why it's used in science is if, let's say, 50 people are doing that same prayer, that same meditation at the same time, then you can actually see the physiological impact of how that feels. And so that's how science is actually doing science, by actually using religious and spiritual practices. So it's kind of nice that it's that East meets West, so to speak. It's all kind of, many things are coming together in a really lovely, harmonious way now.
Fantastic. The next question, which is quite a technical one, which is from Rosie. Is the kindness hormone serotonin, or are there others involved?
The main kindness hormone is oxytocin. It's the female reproductive hormone, but it has multiple roles in the body. The gene for it, as I said, is one of the oldest in the human genome. It has multiple roles. For example, it helps to lower blood pressure. It plays the role as an antioxidant and anti-inflammatory. It actually helps with digestion in the gut, something called gastric motility. It also helps with the process of stem cells morphing into brand new cells, particularly cells in the heart. It plays a role in regeneration of lots of cells. It even plays a role in the regeneration of blood vessels and regeneration of skin. So it has multiple roles. The reason why I don't often call it oxytocin is because many people immediately think, well, it's just, that's its role, it's a reproductive hormone. But in actual fact, it has these multiple different roles, which means that the feelings induced by kindness have an impact in all of these different processes. That's what's really, really great about it. But that's why I call it the kindness hormone. Two reasons. One, to take the technical thing away and so that people don't think it's just about reproduction, because it's also called the love drug, the cuddle chemical, the hugging hormone. It has other affectionate names as well. It has I call it the kindness hormone, principally to draw that parallel with stress. Because most people, when you say, what's the opposite of stress? Most people say, well, it's peace or it's calm, it's tranquility. Those are not the opposites of stress. That's the absence of stress. The opposite of stress, physiologically speaking, is kindness, or it's how kindness feels. And so because of that parallel in terms of how it's produced, that's mostly why I refer to it as the kindness hormone. Thanks for that. That's a great question.
It's a great question. And it's also a great answer, actually. And I love this. This is the antidote to stress. It's not the absence of stress. It's something that acts actively against it. I think that's a really nice way of capturing it. Again, skipping on, there's a couple of questions here. One from Fiona, one from Beth. And it's about how we seek the balance, David. We hear a lot about being kind to ourselves. And you've spoken a lot about being kind to others. And how we strike that balance between being kind to ourselves and being kind to others. Yes. And bearing in mind that we can't always do everything, right? Because there are so many hours in the day and only so much energy in our bodies. How do we get the balance right between those two?
Yeah, you know, this is actually, I think this is what most people find the hardest to do. And maybe a good way to think about it is it needn't be one or the other. Like, you don't be kind to yourself instead of others. Neither are you kind to yourself before others or after others. It doesn't say anything about others at all. Just be kind to yourself as well as others. And I think sometimes if we just get out the habit of putting a position on it, whether it comes first or after, and just say, be kind to yourself as well as others, then you'll find that in some situations, you will act for others first. But then in other situations, you'll find the most appropriate thing to do is take a breath first yourself, because there are times in your life when you really need to take that breath. You really need to look after your own mental health before you, because sometimes I think many people are so naturally compassionate and so naturally kind that you end up wearing yourselves out. And I've done the same myself. Some people call it compassion fatigue. Maybe I think that's the term. And you're just so giving all the time. And so sometimes you have to just take a big deep breath and go, I need to find, this is for my mental health. And if I look after my mental health here by just treating myself right now in whichever way I need to for me right now, then I will actually be able to give more. I will be more of service to other people if I recharge my batteries right now. So it's not about the order, whether I be kind to myself before others or instead of others. It's just as well as others. And you'll find that where that lands will be different at different times, depending on the situation that you're in. If that makes sense.
It does make sense. It does make sense. And that does call for a degree of self-awareness, David, on that front.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Alim asks, and others asked a similar sort of question, David, which is, how do we begin the process of encouraging people down the path that you've mentioned? How do you get started? How do you practically turn this into a different way of thinking, a different way of living?
Yeah, well, I think there's lots of things that we can do other in addition to what we've spoken about already, by just deciding to become alert to it, and also people and organizations deciding how can I bring this from the background to the forefront as part of our identity, as part of a project that's continually ongoing in the company. I think another thing for us to do is just become aware of the science that's available. You know, I think that's where I go to often. I mean, I'm a trained scientist, so I default to that kind of stuff. And I just love to know that all this kind of science is actually available. But, you know, I think another way we can look at this is I sometimes set people a wee challenge. I call it the 7-day kindness challenge. And you can set this for friends, family, teams, even in wee online groups. You can just say, let's have a go at this. You can extend it to 21 days if you like, but it often gets people started. And the idea is you have to do an act of kindness at least once every day for the next 7 days. Now, I like to put three guidelines into that. The first one is you have to do something different every day. So in other words, you can't, if you make someone a cup of tea today, then you can make them a cup of tea another day over the next 7 days, but it only counts the first time you do it. So you've got to do seven different things in 7 days. The second one is if you can, try to push yourself out of your comfort zone at least once. And what that means is not just the safe things, like I'll pay a compliment, I'll make someone a cup of tea. Maybe some things that just, I suppose, maybe just stretches that little bit. In the same way that you might, if you want your body to be more flexible, you stretch your muscles. Or if you're training to run a 10K, you just push a little bit harder. So just if it's possible and safe, then something slightly, a little bit of a stretch. And the third guideline is one of your acts of kindness has to be completely anonymous. So no one must know what you did. Or if people have become aware of something that was done, no one gets to know that it was you, at least not for a while anyway. And what that does, it takes the ego out of it. It takes any sense of satisfaction or praise out of the equation. And it means it's really just for the heartfelt benefit of someone else. When you practice a 7-day kindness challenge with those little guidelines, maybe as signposts, it does get you started on that little kind of roller, because you realize it's actually really enjoyable. But secondly, you're really helping people, even if it's some small things, because you'll probably find in that 7 days that you'll say or do things that you maybe wouldn't have done otherwise. Some people might have had compliments, some people might have had some things said or done. Maybe you just picked up the phone and phone someone to check up on them that you might not have done had you not committed to the 7-day thing. So almost it gets that muscle working, it kind of lubricates the kindness joints, if you like, and gets kind of started on the practice, I suppose.
And is there evidence just on that, on flexing the muscle, David? I mean, is there evidence that you mentioned it's contagious across individuals, but is it like a habit within individuals as well, that you know, the sooner you start exercising that muscle, the more likely you are to keep on exercising that muscle throughout your life? I mean, this takes us back to the schooling thing, really, that should this be, you know, built in from the cradle onwards, so that it's a habit that we get into from the earliest time?
Yeah, you know, I don't know any formal research that's set out to specifically do that, but certainly within some of the research, there has been the occasional comments of people just enjoying the practice and just extending it. Personally, and in people that I've interacted with, I found that the more you practice it, the more you want to keep doing it because you recognize that it's actually helping. And you also, I guess, not the selfish side of it, but you do notice that it does feel nice. And I think that's partly nature's reward. I think nature is rewarding us and saying, yes, more of this, please. You know, if we want to keep thriving as a species, we have to work together. We have to help each other out. We have to find common ground. We've got to find a way to help each of us. I think of everyone in the world as an extension of family. You know, we're all in this human family together. You know, there are ways that we can find common ground. There's ways that we can help each other out and look out for each other. And I think the more you get into the habit of that, the more you enjoy it and the more it feels good. And I think it is nature's way of saying yes. Yeah, I sometimes call this nature's catch-22. Like, you can't actually get a emotional, psychological or physical benefit of kindness unless you mean it. You can't just say, oh, I've heard that there's all these positive side effects, I call them side effects, of kindness. I'm just going to go and do all these acts of kindness and then not really mean it, because you won't get any benefit then. I mean, other people will benefit, of course, but you won't, because the only way to get the benefits is because of how kindness feels. And the only way to get that feeling is if you mean it. So it's like you have to mean it to feel it. So I think of this as nature's catch-22, that nature's making sure that you're doing it for the right reasons, that you're being kind because it's the right thing to do. And then that's how we thrive, when you actually mean it, when you're actually trying to help. Because I think when the mind is open and you're pointing, the mind is saying, I really want to help people, I think that's when we start seeing solutions that you might have missed in the past. I've noticed that the mind becomes more creative then. You start to have ideas and thoughts that you've never considered before, because the focus hasn't been kindness. That hasn't been far enough up in our conscious awareness before. And so once it becomes higher in the conscious awareness, it starts to inform the nature of some of the choices we make and the nature of some of the decisions that we make and the directions that we go in. It might not radically change things all of the time, but there'll certainly be enough times that having that consciousness of kindness might just cause a little nudge here and a little change in decision here, a little choice there that's different from how it was before. That's certainly what I've noticed.
Fantastic. I'm going to take a question that's actually quite close to the Bank of England's heart, actually, which is a couple of questions from Owen and from John. And the questions are, is kindness compatible with competition? And in particular, if kindness is good for mental and physical health, is greed bad for mental and physical health? How do we get that balance again between the sort of cooperative and the competitive, David?
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's about finding that subtle that subtle balance. Well, you know, I would say, first of all, greed can be bad, especially if you become so single-minded about it that you're losing touch with the natural sense of how kindness feels, because we almost need to be topping up the kindness hormone to deliver all these physical benefits. I mean, research shows that the more practice we have that are producing the kindness hormone, especially in how we interact with each other, then the healthier our cardiovascular systems tend to be. So if we take that feeling out of it by not practicing kindness, so if we went the opposite extent and everything was just about greed, then it's not that that's necessarily bad for us, but we take away much of the protective effect that you get from being kind, from the kindness hormone. So I think it is compatible with competition if we can do it in a way where we bring the awareness of kindness to it. Well, actually, can I use an analogy from tennis? So I live in Dunblane. Famous for Andy and Jamie Murray. And I play tennis. I'd never picked up a racket in my life until we moved to Dunblane 4 years ago. And I absolutely love it. Now, some of my friends think it's funny that when I'm on the tennis court, even in a match that's very important to win, because the club league systems, I'm talking up the player. Great shot. Oh, I keep trying to break through your backhand, but you know, you just keep deflecting it back. That's so good. And what I'm actually doing, I'm trying to win, but at the same time, I'm quite happy to point out what you're doing really well. And what happened? What a magical thing happens. That person's game becomes even better, but so does mine. Because I'm not now trying to find, I'm not trying to cheat them out of anything. I'm not trying to, you know, make sure, pray that they mess up their shot. Because my consciousness is now, I really want you to play well. All of a sudden, I'm playing my best ever tennis. I play better when I'm trying to help the other person. We're still competing. We're still having a competition. And at the end of the day, you know, it will, the ball will land where it lands and someone will win and someone will lose. But it's, but because of the way, the spirit that we bring to it, we always end up, you know, you touch rackets at the end, you know, you socially distant touching rackets, and you always ends good spirited. So you can have competition with a consciousness of kindness. And what will happen then is there may well sometimes be times where a decision or a choice just subtly tweaks a little bit. And it doesn't mean you have to lose so that someone else can win, but maybe there's a way that you can both win and everyone can win. But I say sometimes without the consciousness of kindness, you might never know that such a solution exists because you've never tried it before. It was a surprise to me when I started playing so well by complimenting my opponent's good shots. Now, that doesn't happen in Wimbledon, I know, because obviously you know, it's very, very serious there. But that's what it happens in Dunblane tennis, at the courts of Dunblane Tennis Club for sure. And I think that's getting contagious because I notice other people doing it as well now.
We haven't had Andy or Jamie Murray on, but Judy Murray is a previous flagship speaker, actually. She was fantastic.
Judy, such a lovely person. Really,
she is, exactly. I'll just say, you know, external perception, very competitive, but actually incredibly kind of what she had to say. Fantastic.
Absolutely.
I'm going to try to squeeze in two more questions, David, with your indulgence. One of which, an important one actually, is kindness to animals. So where does that fit in? Does that give you the same buzz?
It absolutely does. In fact, you know, one of my favourite statistics is the chances of a second heart attack. Someone has had a heart attack already. The chances of a second one within 12 months and someone who's had one already, if they have a dog, is 400% less. Now, you might think, well, surely that's due to the exercise. And of course, exercise plays a role. But it's only partly due to the exercise. A large contributing factor is the frequent positive bonding that you have with the dog. And you would probably get the same from cats, rabbits, and horses. Just the research was historically done with dogs. Front page in one of the highest ranked scientific journals in the world, a couple of years ago, picture of a yellow Labrador. It really spoke to me because I lost my dog a few years ago. I was only 2 years old, died of bone cancer, Oscar. And so I love animals. And it was a dog that looked so like Oscar. And scientists were measuring levels of the kindness hormone over 30 minutes as people interacted warmly with the dog. And amazingly, as they interacted with the dog, levels of the kindness hormone increased at an average rate of greater than 10% per minute. Not 10% in total after 30 minutes, 10% per minute over the 30 minutes. There was more than 300% increase in levels of the kindness hormone just by doing nothing other than warmly, playfully, lovingly interacting with the dog. And it's just the same way that if you're kind to a human being, you get the same effect. And what the study was showing is the same thing happens when you extend that love, compassion, kindness to animals as well. So part of that statistic isn't just the exercise, it's the loving connection that you have in addition to the exercise. But it's the same with animals as it is with human beings as well. It comes down to how it feels.
Brilliant. And my dog has made no intervention during this seminar, which I'm also delighted about, actually. Last quick, we're into overtime, David, and I want to ask you a last question. It's a question that several of the audience members have asked about, which is how do we change business? How do we change the culture of business? How do we change the business of business to embed these the science and the practice that you've set out so brilliantly today within them on an enduring basis. Businesses, like everyone, are facing their own constraints, their own trade-offs. They don't have limitless amounts of time or energy or people. So what could we do for organizations like the bank, for the organizations like, you know, many of those that people on the call today will work for? What can we all take away and take back to our organizations to embed all the great stuff you've set out today?
Well, you know, first of all, I would say, you know, share this video. And I say that not for selfish reasons. I say that because it's about educating everyone within the company about not only the value of kindness and how much it makes a difference in the world through the ripple effect, but that it's actually really healthy, that it's the opposite, the antidote to stress. You know, once people understand that there really are all these real psychological and mental and emotional happiness generating, physiological, cardiovascular, immunological benefits to the immune system, the aging process, once people actually know that there is evidence here, that the science of it, I think the first thing to do is bring that into the organization, let people know about it. Once there's an awareness of it, then organizations will, you'll find spontaneously say, how do we keep this going in our company? And the solutions will come within the businesses by people who are the best placed to come up with the solutions, because you're actually working there and saying, look at how my company works. What we could do, because now we have this awareness of all the benefits, we have to do something with it. And so the solutions will literally organically grow from within organizations by the people best placed to find those solutions, if that makes sense. But I think it's bringing the knowledge, bringing the understanding, bringing the science, I guess, in to the organizations.
Brilliant. David, we should definitely bring things to a close, because we're deep into overtime now. Let me just extend my huge thanks to all the audience for joining us. That are kind of fantastic, more than 400 people in the audience. Thanks for all of your questions. I apologize for not getting through more of them, but actually we managed to get through a lot of them, and we can pick up some of the extra ones maybe outside. One of the comments actually, David, was how much people were appreciating your pink flamingo behind you. The next flagship speaker is Tanny Gray Thompson on the 17th of May. So I hope as many of you as possible can sign up for that. But last, but of course by no means least, a particular thanks to David today for coming along. And you spoke, David, about, you know, taking the concepts, the science, the thinking, the practices into all of our organizations and causing those ripple effects you mentioned earlier on. I absolutely hope we can do that. I think there's huge amounts more all of us can do to sprinkle the kindness that you've been sprinkling over the course of the past hour across our organizations and indeed across our family lives as well. So David, on behalf of everyone at the bank and everyone that's listened in today, a huge thanks from all of us.
Thank you. It's been my absolute pleasure. Thanks to you, Andy. I felt that this has just been a chat, just a conversation, and I really appreciated being invited to talk here. And also thanks to you and all the audience for the really terrific questions that have came. You know, I think the questions have really helped us to get into dimensions that we might not have got into otherwise. So thanks to everyone who's been part of this today.
Brilliant. Thanks, everyone. Have a nice afternoon.